This is a demonstration of Wirecast. This is a demonstration of Wirecast. This is a demonstration of Wirecast.
Hello and welcome to Greg City Academy, where we've got a very special Speakers for Schools debate. We're in partnership with the TES, and it's all about trying to assess what that vote that the nation took last week to leave the European Union, what it means for all of us. And I'm very excited because, of course, the implications of this vote are greatest for those who are youngest, because it is the younger people in our society who are going to have to live with the consequences. And therefore, it's very exciting for me that we're going to get questions from people, not just here in Greg City Academy, but from schools all over the country via social media. And I've immediately forgotten what our hashtag is, so I'm going to have to look it up. What is the great hashtag? The hashtag is... here we go. Hashtag EU what now? So if you attach that to your questions, we will find it easier to track you. Now, I'm going to ask our brilliant panel to tell us a little bit about themselves, and I'm going to be very mean initially, since you're going to get a lot of time to talk about your views in a bit. But initially, I just want you to say in one word how you felt when you heard the result of the great vote. So perhaps we could start with you, Dreda Saint Michel. Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you felt when you heard the result.
Okay, let me say my name first of all. It's Dreda Saint Mitchell.
Oh, sorry.
Mitchell as in Peggy. Oh.
Right.
How did I feel? I voted Leave. I was still surprised, but actually when I stepped back, I could understand how it had happened.
But it went the way you wanted.
It did, but I was still surprised. I didn't expect us to vote for Leave, but now I kind of fully understand why that happened.
Owen.
Hi, I'm Owen. I'm a Guardian columnist, author. I'm 31, even though I look younger than most people in the room. It's embarrassing. I love my country, and I've never been more terrified for its future. And that's how I felt.
And I'm Miriam. I'm one of those European immigrants. I'm Spanish, living in this country for 10 years. I'm an international trade lawyer. And when I heard the results, I felt devastated, really.
You felt?
Devastated.
Devastated. Devastated. So there were a number of different reactions. Nobody up here saying they were elated. I was quite interested to see, as it were. Is Chanel somewhere in the audience? Hello, Chanel. Would you mind standing up? Is that okay?
Yes.
So what's your question for the panel?
In each panelist's opinion, what will be the impact, what will be the number one impact of leaving the EU for a teenager?
For a teenager, what will be the number one impact? Should we start with Miriam?
Well, I think that it's important that you are thinking about the impact, if I may start with that. I focus very much on the business repercussions. I have been, for the last few days, 24 hours, attending to questions from businesses. And I think that many others out there are not really thinking about the impact yet. There are half of the population who is kind of living in planet cuckoo land, not knowing what has happened, and another half thinking, doing wishful thinking of, I wish this would not have happened. And I think that is absolutely right that we focus on what next, and how does this affect me? I think that from your point of view, I can only tell you what I tell my children. I have a 14 years old and then 12 and 7. I think that the main consequence of this for you is that this week you have many less chances to have your professional future in this country than you had last week. And therefore, you need to be completely pragmatic about the fact that there are things that translate better into other markets, that you need to be looking outside, that when the market becomes smaller, you need to make your world bigger, really. So look outside, travel. I think that language is really important, and be the part of, citizen of the world, that in a way is the opposite to the political decision that took place last week.
Owen Jones.
Blimey. How will it affect teenagers? Well, look, I often like to talk about hope and optimism, but I'd be lying if I said anything other than that it is you who will grow up now in the greatest crisis this country has now faced since the end of the war. And there's no point pretending otherwise. Last night, I spoke to a young Polish a young Romanian woman, I spoke to a Polish woman last week, a young Romanian woman. She was in her early 20s, not a teenager, but early 20s. And she said she feels like the country hates her and she feels scared to leave her house. And that is a story, I'm afraid, that is being heard all over the country at the moment and is being reported all over social media. A young BBC journalist of Asian extraction who had racial abuse thrown at him in the streets, a word he hadn't used against him, he said, since the 1980s. It's not that. 52% of the population are racist or xenophobic. They're not. Lots of people I grew up with in Stockport voted to leave the European Union. They're angry and they're frustrated and they feel the people at the top have nothing but contempt for them. The danger this country now faces is that racists and xenophobes think 52% of the population agree with them and they feel legitimised. The whole campaign was about immigration in the most poisonous way. We should talk about people's grievances about immigration, but it was toxic. And in terms of the other impacts, there'll be a huge economic turmoil as a response. Younger people we know from the last few years suffer most. You're the ones who've already paid most because of the cuts we faced. Workers' rights now under threat because they're guaranteed as part of EU membership. Younger workers, whether you be teenagers or in your 20s, you're going to be the ones now who suffer in terms of those workers' rights. Your country may fall apart because Scotland is likely to leave. Your right to free movement across Europe in terms of studying, travelling, settling down with someone, all of that is now under threat. I could go on and there's a lot more to talk about, but there are a lot of challenges and my plea to all of you is you've got to do something about this. These problems and fears we face are now very great, but it is up to your generation to organise and stand against the threats you now face. We can still build a different country that is just and accepting, and unless you all do something about it now, then I worry about the future of this country. It really is in your hands at the moment.
So, Dreda, I saw you shaking your head. You don't agree.
Good then. You know, my perspective in life, I think we've got slightly different backgrounds. I have to feel upbeat. I have to feel optimistic, because let me tell you now, I wouldn't have got to where I am in my life if I hadn't. I grew up on a council estate in the East End of London. I still live on a council estate in the East End of London. My parents were migrants. They came over here in the early 60s. My grandparents came over in the 50s and settled in Sheffield, where my grandfather became a steel worker. So for me, things have always been tough when I was young. The world was always seemed to be against me. So it's interesting when people talk about the world being against young people. I've been there, and do you know what? You have to strive to move forward as a young person, particularly some people in here from ethnic minority groups, some people here who belong to white working class families. The world anyway probably wouldn't have been, you know, it would have been hard for you to conquer. So the one thing I leave for young people is be upbeat. I see the vote as leave, people starting to take control. I disagree with Owen to some degree. I think the Labour Party, which we'll talk about, allowed the Conservative Party to take the Leave agenda. So, in the main, it became an agenda about immigration. However, there were lots of people like myself who were voting for Leave because of democracy. What we felt was that Britain hasn't got all of its democracy. My democratic rights were being eroded because in the EU, they had a say in our laws in this country. And I think that is actually wrong. Owen talks about workers' rights being guaranteed by the EU. And I'm actually scandalised because workers' rights, the best type of workers' rights, should be generated in this democracy, should be generated in this democracy. And I actually feel quite aggrieved as a Labour supporter. No, I've not finished, Owen. I'm still talking. As a Labour supporter, when I hear the Labour Party actually saying the only way they can guarantee workers' rights outside of Britain, I'm very, very shocked about that. I see this as a moment of change. I've never viewed myself as European, strangely, British, Londoner, and a person of the world. This is an opportunity for Britain to open up the world. So it's an opportunity for you not to just think about work within Europe, because we're not leaving Europe. We've left an organisation, or we're leaving an organisation called the EU. Think about work in other parts of the world. Canada, America. This is an opportunity for you. And I have to say, just from my experience of life, we have to be upbeat. We have to think about how we can do this together. Because you know what? If we don't, we will never get there.
We've got so much to get through, and you'll have opportunities to come back on each other as it goes on. But do you mind if I just get to the next question?
Can I make one little point?
If it's
because
little.
You have spoken about your background, and I keep getting upset about having these kinds of conversations with lots of different people. I have been reading about your background. You come from comprehensive schools, and then you managed to go to Oxford. I come from the village school in my country, none at all a privileged background. So can we put that on the table? Because I just don't know why whenever we discuss about something like this, we have all this issue like, well, suddenly because I have from a, you speak about it,
but it's
like if suddenly you have a different
but
background.
It's important
I don't come from any privileged background. I have been working hard on my life.
I tell you why it's important for me, because many of the students here in this room come from a similar background to myself, generated
my
in London.
And they're going to suffer. And I'm afraid, Dreda, you say people have to strive against all the odds stacked against them. But the odds, and they do, of course people have
of
to strive.
Course.
But the odds stacked against the people in this room are now greater than they were last Thursday. That's the reality.
That's
and it never needed to happen. Okay?
Now, at some point I probably won't be able to resist the temptation to join in, but for now I am going to, because I want to hear from you. Where's Natisha, please? Natisha.
How has this event affected community cohesion?
Right. Another very uncontroversial question. I'm going to start with you, Dreda, actually, this time.
I'm trying to unpick what you mean by community cohesion. Is it a question about racism? Is it a question about community cohesion? Because it's a big, big thing. Community cohesion.
Well, I would say mainly racism, possibly.
Right. So let's talk about the racism. It has been absolutely shocking what has been going on, and you know the Leave campaign, the official Leave campaign, asked me to join them, and I refused to join them. And one of the reasons I refused to join them is I knew they could not resist the slide into immigration. What I would say is it's good that it has been noticed that this is all happening. The backslide for me on that is racism has been happening in this country for a long time and the media haven't been taken notice. So it's good the media have finally started to actually take notice of it. I tell people about an issue that happened to me, and I talked about this last night in relation to the EU as well, is I came back, this was maybe 5 years ago, with some colleagues who were all white. We came back from France. We got to the French bit. Who was the only person who was stopped? It was me. And one of the questions that was asked me was, how is it that you've got a British passport? So when we talk about freedom of movement across Europe, sometimes it's not being so free and easy for people. And the other thing that I would say is, the other side to the racism that's been shown is I know a lot of people who voted Leave, including myself, who've been getting hate emails from people, who've been getting hate tweets. If I told you the number of people I've had to block this week on Twitter, it has just been absolutely amazing. And that's why I say we need to get to a position of where we need to come together. Because if we don't come together, this kind of tension on both sides will just escalate and get out of hand. And that is not the type of Britain that I want to be living in.
Owen Jones.
In terms of community cohesion, we're now more bitterly divided as a country again since the end of the war. No point pretending otherwise. There were two groups of people who most strongly voted for Remain. One was young people, about three quarters of 18 to 25 year olds, those who voted, admittedly, voted to stay within the European Union. The other was people from black and minority ethnic backgrounds who overwhelmingly voted to stay within the European Union. And look, I'd say this, Dreda, there were so many good reasons to put forward in a progressive way to leave, or from a left-wing perspective, to leave the European Union. But anybody could have seen during that referendum campaign that we were not voting about the European Union anymore. We were voting about immigration and our attitudes towards foreigners.
I disagree. You know I've talked about
you didn't like me. You didn't like me interrupting
okay.
you. So
all right,
you're gonna.
Do it at school. I shall save it.
You will save it.
I will say it.
You're free to say it when it's your turn. In terms of the campaign, because you said the media finally taking notice of racism.
Absolutely.
Dreda, come on.
Absolutely. Sorry, I'm just affirming which is a black thing that people do. Sorry. Yeah, go on.
During the campaign, they didn't notice racism and xenophobia. They fanned it.
The headlines all the way through this campaign, like, we're from Europe. The Daily Mail splashed on their front page a load of migrants, dark-skinned. These were portrayed as coming hordes of people coming from Europe. They weren't. They were actually from Iraq. The Daily Mail printed a correction the next day on page 2, which was about this big. The rhetoric was about the threat of Turks coming into this country because they lied. They said that Turkey was joining the European Union, which they're not, and that won't happen for decades. And that would mean we would have Turkish criminals coming into this country. How are people who are Turkish supposed to feel about that in this country? Whether it be dossiers of rapists and murderers from Europe to try and portray people from Europe as though we're being threatened by murderers and rapists coming into this country. Foreigners and immigrants all the way through this campaign were portrayed as threats, as criminals, as potential murderers, as potential rapists. And the problem is now people fought at great cost and great sacrifice against xenophobia and bigotry and racism, and we pushed a lot of it back. But it's now being legitimised. We've gone hurtling back decades, and people in the streets of this country now are getting abused by people, including in Manchester. I don't know if people saw this video circulating around social media. People yelling, going, get out, you immigrant, get out, you immigrant. Because they think we've got 52% of the population behind us. It's not true. That's not what the 52% all think. People I grew up had lots of different reasons to vote Leave. But there's no question, because the Leave campaign decided the only way they could win this referendum was fanning fears about foreigners and immigrants, that now as a consequence, lots of people think we left the European Union to kick out foreigners and immigrants. And people do not distinguish between immigrants and people who don't seem to look like a white Briton. And that is the danger with community cohesion. There's lots of others. Scotland feel very angry now because they've been dragged out of the European Union against their will, as has London, for that matter, because London overwhelmingly voted to stay. Young people feel angry because they feel they've been dragged out of the European Union against their will by older people. So it's young versus old. It's in terms of race, in terms of those divisions, class, nation. This country faces lots of very big difficulties. But it is, I'm afraid, a con to say anything other than as a consequence of this referendum, racism and xenophobia have been legitimised, and we have the fight of our lives, the fight of our lives to drive it back. And we're going to have to do what people did decades ago if we're going to drive it back. But it's up to you in this room. I plead with you. Don't let this wave of xenophobia and racism succeed, because at the moment they think they're winning.
Miriam.
I'm a European living in this country. I was actually wondering, are there many of you here? Are there other people from other European countries? One, I see there. So I think a few. I think it is quite important for everybody who is not to understand how we feel. So I have been living here for 10 years. I have been contributing to this country. I have been paying taxes in this country. I have been running campaigns in this country. And this country has a referendum about whether they want to stay with the European Union or not. And first of all, I'm not given the right to vote. So I have had to watch this car crash, not only with the country I love, where I came to live, not out of need. In my case, it was out of choice, because I like the principles that you had here. I didn't come here because of the weather or because whatever, shopping in Harrods. I like the principles. You know, this was a tolerant society. This was a place where I came from the continent where, you know, I was being treated a bit like whatever you have done in the past is what determines your future. And suddenly I came to this country that you all have, that looks at you like the individual. And the kind of possibilities that you have suddenly was like, wow, you know, this is me. I'm in control of my own life. And suddenly I have seen all that gone without having the chance to do pretty much anything about it. But in the process of doing all that, they have told us that we were responsible for the house crisis. Listen, I'm married to a politician. I know what is responsible for the house crisis, that they haven't been putting the priority into housing. That we were responsible for the collapse of the steel industry. I'm a trade lawyer. I know that if the steel industry has collapsed, it was because this country didn't take the right political decisions to keep it running. We have been told that we were responsible for sexual assaults. How did you think that we were feeling about it? And now you think that the Prime Minister can go to Europe as he did 2 days ago and to say, well, this was your fault because of freedom of movement of people. Honestly, this is a joke. And for me, the most important thing is that this country was an incredible country. It has to continue being an incredible country no matter what happens. We need to get into practical mode. We need to sort out the relationship with the European Union and others. And each of us needs to think, what can we do to make this better? And in your case, do you see anybody resorting to racism, to recrimination, to resentment? Stop it. Stop it. Ask them to stop. Because at the end of the day, this is not for the government, or it's not for the establishment or whatever. This is for us, each one of us. When I have seen in my firm that somebody was recriminating somebody else, I stopped it. You do as well, because it's, you know, Owen is absolutely right. It's in your hands, and you are the generation that is going to either suffer from this, or perhaps, hopefully, my hope is that you will raise from this, and hopefully you will take this in a different direction.
Now, because we're running slightly out of time, or we're using up the time quite quickly, I'd like to take two questions at once, please. Where's Espoir? Okay, and then if you could give it the microphone straight away to Stephen, please. Okay, thank you.
Should the threshold for referendum victory be changed to 60%?
So basically, this is a question about whether a straight, simple majority, which is the rule here, should be a big enough vote for a change of quite as big as this. And then where's Stephen, please?
Many schools have many students from EU countries. Will Brexit affect immigration? And if it does, how will it affect it?
So that's a very big question. A lot of the campaign was about immigration, but actually, will levels of immigration fall if we still haven't left, actually? I should point out to all of you, although we voted to leave, we haven't actually yet left the European Union. I think on the threshold question, keep it reasonably short, and then let's talk a little bit about immigration, please. So, Miriam.
Well, I was against convening the referendum when it was convened altogether. So for me, whether it was 50% or not, it was the secondary question. This country had legislation to have a referendum whenever there was the next big revision of the treaty. And I think that that's what should have happened, rather than taking a gamble with the whole country, as it has been the case. I personally think that when it happens, it could be better. Whenever there is a big change, it's normally better to have more of a qualified majority. But you know, for me, that is a secondary issue.
And will immigration fall or change in some way, do you think?
We don't really know, is the answer. And part of the reason we don't really know is that nobody in the Leave campaign or in the government, the current government, is saying, what is the plan B? So what is going to happen now? If whatever is going to happen doesn't include the free movement of people, certainly it will have an impact. And it would mean that it is not possible to come here and perhaps stay here without visas or without a sponsoring, et cetera, et cetera. But that we don't know, and it depends on what they are going to negotiate. What I can tell you is that from the business point of view, we see that people are going to embassies to try to apply for, you know, all the papers for residence, that they are trying to get their nationalities that they could get. Some businesses have started speaking about sponsoring. So yeah, it is massive uncertainty, and we need a signal from the country. I think that the Prime Minister, was it yesterday? He spoke about freedom of movement. He was saying everything will continue as it is until we leave. What we need is the clarity about what happens afterwards.
Dreda.
I think if it's I completely agree, this referendum never, the reasons behind it, you know, it never needed to actually happen. I think if you're going to take a vote and it's each person, it should be 50%. I don't think it should actually change.
Can I just make one point about that, though? Because one of the sort of interesting things about votes like this is that the population is in a state of flux. So if you do a little bit of simple maths about how many people will be 18 over the next 2 or 3 years and able to vote, and you look at the way that 18-year-olds have been voting, and if you think about the number of people who are going to die over the next 3 years, and you also think about a little bit of about the maths of how many people become naturalised citizens and able to vote, actually, on the basis of the way people voted in this vote, in 3 years' time, we would have had a different outcome because actually people, you know, are becoming. So there is something slightly weird about a 50% simple majority, because in 3 years' time you'd have the same vote, exactly the same patterns of voting, and you'd have a different answer.
No. If I may, for me, it's not so much the 50%. What I think is a disgrace is that the 16 to 18 years old were not allowed to vote.
But
that's the disgrace, it's not the 50%.
But that's how it is in this democracy, you know.
Well, no, it was put for a vote in the parliament.
For an election, that's how actually the, it
is. Yeah, but this determines in an election,
I don't,
you change
I think we've been talking in a really ageist way about our older folk who have helped make this country into what it is, and we shouldn't forget that about this country. Immigration, I don't know what's going to happen. I'm with you completely. Don't know what's going to happen about immigration. I just wanted to very briefly just pick up on some of the things that Owen mentioned. You know, of all the people sitting here, I don't know what everybody else's story. I grew up at a time in Britain, you know, the type of racism people are talking about now. Wow, you should have grown up when I was growing up here. I used to go to school with signs on the wall that said KBW, Keep Britain White, in the kind of part of London we come from. Some of those areas that are very fashionable now, one area, Hoxton, if you were black, you couldn't go into Hoxton. The National Front, which was an equivalent of the BNP, was around there. Those were tough times, and people came through them, but they came through them together. And I'm completely with you. You have to do it together. But we've been here before. This is not new to some of us, you see.
We have been here. I mean, I grew up in North London. I grew up very close to here, actually. I went to the school down the road, Highgate Wood. And it's true, in the 60s and 70s, when I was growing up, there was much more racism and tension between different communities. But the thing is, actually, if over the last 20 odd years, this has been a country in which racism has simply not been
but
a people feature.
People would disagree with you. What we found out from, I don't know if people heard about the murder of Stephen Lawrence back in the 90s. Mm. What that very clearly showed was the biggest type of racism that most people from ethnic minority groups will ever face is institutional racism. So this is institutions that are there on behalf of the community who operate in a way that excludes and whole groups of people. And I'm a bit worried with our racism debate that what we're moving back to is, when I was growing up, it was very much a debate, who were the racists in our country? The racists are those white working class people. And sure, you'll get people there, but who are the people who are running our institutions that have been shown to be institutionally racist? These are very often white, liberal, middle-class people. So I disagree with you, Robert. Racism never went away.
It's always a seedy undercurrent, but it has. But it was, frankly, it was less conspicuous than it is now.
I disagree with you. If you were black, you would know the biggest type of racism you would ever face in your life is from an institution. It's not from everyday people in the street calling you names and saying stuff to you. And that is the type of racism that you as a person, if you're from a black minority ethnic group, that you will be having to fight. I'm still fighting it now. It's still not gone away.
Owen.
Look, there was a referendum, we lost. And I can start now coming up with sour grapes and changing thresholds, but we lost. And over 50% of the population, it's 52% against 48%. A win is a win. And there's no point me now going back and talking about thresholds. The turnout was high, pretty high for an election, and that's what the people of this country decided. And I'm not going to start dividing up young versus old and all the rest. Yes, it's true, younger people will suffer the greatest consequences of a decision that was made mostly by people older than them, but there's no point. A British voter is a British voter. Mm. That's the decision they made, and I'm not happy about the result. I'm terrified about the consequences, but we lost. In terms of immigration, well, basically, the Leave campaign not just only incited bigotry, it was based on lies, total lies. Most immigration coming into this country comes from outside the European Union. Absolutely critical. Over the last few years, that's been dramatically the case. Okay, so you've got to bear that in mind. We already had control over most of that. In terms of government policies, often mean we have to bring people in. So For example, at the moment, last year, the government had to recruit one in four nurses abroad, having cut nurse training places every single year. We don't train the nurses we need, so we have to bring nurses in from other countries. So it's not, it's a case of need. Do you see? So that won't change, because we're still going to cut back on nurse training places. And the truth is, and because as soon as the referendum was over and the vote was clear, Daniel Hannan, a Conservative politician, one of the most prominent leaders of the Leave campaign, he went on television in the early hours and said, oh, no, we're not saying that the immigration numbers will change. They backtracked immediately on their key pledge, which is to reduce immigration, which is the reason they won the referendum in the first place. There's no evidence, compelling evidence, to suggest immigration will fall. If it does, it won't be in a way that anybody even notices. You know, if you had a drop of 10,000 people, that's the equivalent of, I think it's about 14 people in every constituency. Is anybody going to notice that? Obviously not. And all I'd say about immigration, the reason I'm frustrated, is this. It is, as Miriam said, has been a very convenient way for a long time for politicians to pass the buck. The reason we don't have enough housing in this country isn't because of immigrants. It's because we have the lowest house building in peacetime since the 1920s. The reason we don't have secure jobs isn't because of immigrants. It's because politicians have let industries go to waste without replacing them, like steel, for example, where Britain blocked efforts by the European Union to take measures to defend our own steel industry. The reason we have falling wages isn't because of immigrants. It's because we don't have strong enough trade unions and government immigrants. It's because we don't have strong enough trade unions and government policies that can defend people's living standards. The reason our public services are under stress isn't because of immigrants. The immigrants keep our National Health Service alive. The NHS would collapse without immigrants. It's because our governments aren't funding public services properly because of cuts. So all the way through this referendum, we've pointed the finger at foreigners, at immigrants, for all the problems and injustices that powerful people at the top are responsible for. They must be laughing hysterically now. Because instead of blaming the right people, we're just blaming people from Poland instead. It's ridiculous.
But not everyone has been doing that. There have been people on the Leave
that
campaign.
That was the Leave official strategy. Yeah, yeah. You know that, Dreda.
Yeah, I do know that.
Do you think there was a case to say, I don't like the European Union, but this time, in this vote, the only terms we're leaving on is opposing immigration, and it will just be seen as a vote about immigration?
No, no.
So this time I'll vote to remain in and campaign...
No. Okay. I could never that, because I'm voting for the status quo. Plus, I disagree with you. I'm not. It's not just about what the Leave campaign are saying, actually.
It was the only
offer. Yeah, but I'm just not. I'm a voter. Can you understand? They might be saying that, but in my heart, I think the first principle is about democracy. And to tell you the truth, the reason I couldn't vote for Remain, even if I would, one, there was no reform to be had in the EU. They weren't budging. And I'm just voting for the status quo.
And I think in fairness to that, you know, it is certainly the case that many of the more prominent campaigners for Leave exploited the immigration issue.
Of course they did.
But it is also clearly the case that lots of people who voted for Leave aren't anti-immigration.
Oh, no.
And lots of people who voted for Leave are passionate about this idea that somehow it is much better for laws to be made by the Parliament without the prospect of those laws being overridden by the European Court. Now, there are lots of important arguments about why that sense of taking control may be an illusion, but there's no question in my mind that people voted out of principle and honestly for good motives. And so I think we should be very careful here not to assume that all people who voted Leave are in some way bad people, anti-immigrant or racist. They're absolutely not.
No one's arguing that. Many of my friends voted Leave.
That wasn't the question. The question was what's going to happen with immigration. And I think that, frankly, with all due respect, you had the chance to vote. I don't really care why you voted, whatever you voted. We are where we are. So what we need to know is what is going to happen next. And the fact is that while some have backtracked on the Leave camp, on the promises on immigration, nobody has said that they are going to backtrack on what they said on the free movement of people. Even those who were on the Remain camp of the Tory party who are in the government today are not saying anything backtracking from the comments that they made on the free movement of people. And therefore, if you are affected by that, you need to think that you need to look yourself for a plan B, because you don't know whether you are going to be able to stay here after the UK leaves the European Union, that it is going to leave, it is irreversible, that's going to happen, it's only about when rather than if. You know, you need to think about, if you want to stay here, how you are going to stay here.
Well, in fairness, again, to the people who ran the Leave campaigns, they did say in terms, I mean, you know, this is not binding because they're not in the government, but they did say in terms that people who are already here under free movement would be able to stay. That is what they said. Now, they may not be able to deliver it, and of course, until it is actually legislated, none of us know. Now, we've got another question, please, from Michael. Where's Michael? Hello, Michael.
To what extent will the political uncertainty affect the economy?
Right, so this is something I'm supposed to know about, so maybe I'll talk a little bit about this. I mean, the answer is it is already affecting the economy. I don't think we need to talk about this at enormous length. One of the facts about the British economy is over the last 20, 30 years, successive governments have said to the world's biggest companies, come and settle here in Britain, because we will be your gateway to the European Union's market, what's known as the single market, right? And we are an economy which is more dependent on those big international economies than more or less any other big economy in the world. We're a very open economy in that sense. Now, because we are so dependent on these big multinationals, many of which have come here in order to sell their goods and services to the rest of Europe, once there is uncertainty about our access to that market, those companies, they stop hiring, they put investment on hold, and some of them are already thinking about, do they need to move their operations to other parts of Europe? Dublin, Frankfurt, Paris, Madrid. And they are all making this evaluation. When companies hire fewer people, when they invest less, there is less money sloshing around. The economy slows down. We're already seeing the early signs of a slowdown. And you know, one of the things I said consistently throughout the campaign is there will be an economic price to pay if we leave because of the structure of our economy. And my own view is that economic price over the next 2 or 3 years might be quite big. You know, I think we probably will have a recession. I don't know how severe that'll be. Now, there is also an argument that says that over 10 to 20 years, if you shape economic policies that suit your country rather than a bigger area, you might over that time be able to become more prosperous, okay? But we shouldn't be under any illusion. When an economy slows down, that is a permanent loss of income, right? That is money that has gone forever. And, you know, it is simply incoherent to pretend that there is not an economic price. And what I said throughout the campaign was that price might be worth paying if you believe in other things, like, you know, the ability to fashion your own laws more suitable to your country. That might be a price worth paying. But it would be, I think, naive to assume, this is what I said, and, you know, I stand by it, to assume there is not a price, an economic price to pay. And I think we are now paying that price. Anybody want to chip in?
Well, he's the economics expert, and you've heard what he said. I mean, Credit Suisse is a bank, and they said Britain was going to grow next year. Now they say it will go into recession. And I suppose it's not just companies who hold off decisions. Households will start to do that as well. They'll stop spending money. They might not buy a house when they were going to buy a house because they don't know where Britain will be in the next couple of years. And I suppose the other point is we could join the European Free Trade Area instead. If you join the European Free Trade Area, you've got to accept freedom of movement. So we wouldn't have any reduction in immigration. We'd also have to pay basically the same amount of money we're paying to the European Union at the moment, unless we can come up with a deal. And one possible deal is basically where there's this thing called passporting for financial institutions, which Miriam will know more about. I mean, I want to rebalance the economy away from the city. I want to do that by promoting new industries, not just allowing the city to suddenly go into crisis. But what that will mean is that passporting gives it this ability to trade across Europe, and what could happen is they'll say, okay, we'll take away freedom of movement, but you have to get takeaway passporting for the city. So basically all the city firms will leave, the city of London will massively hollow out, but hey, we'll have a few less Polish builders, so.
Can I say a tiny bit? Because I think that the question is very relevant and is the uncertainty. I think that what we are facing right now is that we have economic uncertainty, we have political uncertainty, we have constitutional uncertainty, and anybody looking at the country from outside is thinking, this doesn't really look like a country. It looks much more like different communities, including the generational divide, by the way, that do not seem to be able to dream of a common future together. That's where we need to go. At the end of the day, we need to compromise on, in practical terms, where is the common future between everybody. From what I see, that I work all the time with businesses, the key issue that we have now is the legal uncertainty. So it is very difficult for anybody to put money into the country to make new investments or to go ahead with mergers and acquisitions. Well, we don't really know what we are going to be able to do legally with the framework and economically in 3 years' time. You would not be putting your money into something like this. So obviously those very rich guys in business that are thinking of putting much more money are thinking, well, you know, when it's not as stable and it's not clear, why should I do this here? I will take it there. We have seen already deals falling through from Friday. It was quite shocking. I think that the government, I realize why they are going emotionally through this process of, there is all these ups and downs in the Tory party. That meant that the fourth person debating here cannot be here today. But frankly, they should put that aside. We need some answers and we need some framework. And if the framework is the EEA, we need to be told, because every single week that we do not have a clear signal as to what is the framework, we are losing money coming into this country. And my very final point is that I think, Robert, you are absolutely right. For me, there is one thing that is already the victim, clearly, economically, in terms of what can happen in this country, and is what we always had that is called hubbing. So a company from outside would come to the UK because of their language, because of the culture, because it's a very open country. And from here, they would start serving Germany and France and Spain, etc. And then they branch from here. I think that would be gone, because suddenly, no matter how good, unless we are really on the Norwegian model and the EEA, which doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to alleviate the concerns of some, as Owen has said, then you will need to come here and then comply with a different set of rules to have access to the rest of the European market. So I think that bit is gone, really.
Now, we need to get on to some questions from outside of this room, and I've got a very interesting question from Shirebrook Academy, which I think, in a way, goes to the heart of the immigration issue. And it says, and I think I'll start with you, Miriam, because you've already talked a bit about this. Why do people from other EU countries want to come and live and work in the UK?
Well, for me, I have explained that already. I was working in Brussels, and we thought as a family, should we go to the UK? And for me, the main attraction, I could have organized my family in a different way, but the main attraction was coming here and realizing that this is an open culture. You know, I do realize that there is racism and discrimination in lots of different cultures. You never really eradicate it fully. But on the whole, I think that this is such a respectful culture, so based on the individual, so much about you and what you want to do. You know, in Spain and in Brussels and in France, I kept being told all the time, like, what did you study? Oh, you did law. Well, then you can only be a lawyer. And I came here and I remember vividly going to job interviews and it would start, so what do you want to do? I was like, me? You really want to know what I want to do? It was a complete revolution for me. And for me, that was the main attraction, that culture of tolerance. I have to say, though, Robert, that we in Spain have a lot of British people living there. So perhaps we should start asking some of the British people who come to the south of Spain why they want to be there. Because I realize that you in the UK keep looking now at people like me like a cost on your on your system. We have a cost on our system as well from your citizens that go to to our countries. No? So I think that the more we stop looking at all this movement in this economic way only, you know, and we are more realistic. This has been a very insular debate. You are not looking at what is happening outside. No? So we need to look outside.
Dreda.
I'm just thinking, you know, you talk about it being insular, and it's kind of connected to the other question, you know, about the economy. I think for such a long time, and this is why I know people voted Leave, and I've got my family in Sheffield, and we've been living in a very divided country for a very long time. And it was interesting, I did a debate last night at the Guardian. We had a live EU debate. And as a superb journalist who I revere and have been reading for years, Gary Young, and he actually said, you know what, if we hadn't had this debate, we probably wouldn't have realised the type of country we were living in, how many people have been unhappy. And lots of people outside of London and the South have been feeling for a long time that the wealth and prosperity that we've been living in, they haven't been living in themselves for such a long time.
There is a paradox here, isn't there, Dreda? That, I mean, and it is very striking. Here we are in London, where there is more immigration proportionately than in any other part of the country, but we all get along together, and here in London, we voted to remain. Right? On the, you know, there was
on
a,
the
there,
whole...
There was a big vote in favour of Remain, broadly in London. What's really interesting is that the, a lot of the places where they voted to leave, not all of them, but a lot of the places where they voted to leave, there isn't a vast number of... There aren't vast numbers of European of migrants there. But it's true, there are not vast numbers of European migrants there. And I think a lot of the vote to leave was a general sense of people feeling that the country and the economy, particularly the global economy, wasn't being run in a way that benefited them at all. And they, unfortunately, many of them, fixated on immigration as the reason why they weren't getting any better off. But actually, probably isn't the reason they weren't getting better off. And I'll tell you why. One of the reasons people come to work in this country is, certainly for the last 20-odd years, we've been a very successful economy. People came here because there were jobs and more jobs were being created. So it's a sort of paradox that people came because we were successful. Actually, they did jobs well and that made the economy more successful. And there is a genuine risk that if we put the shutters down on immigration, we'll be sort of cutting off our noses to spite our faces, because actually the economy may become a lot less successful. It's in economic terms, this is a very challenging issue. Now, I would also take the view that certainly the elite, the people who run us, did not understand the way that migration changed the nature of communities, and this unsettled and upset lots of people. And I think a lot of people rather dismissed those concerns about stability and a sense of who we are. And I think that was a mistake. But I don't think one can just see this in terms of wages. It's a much bigger question.
Let me give you a statistic here. You were talking about, Owen, you said most black minority ethnic people voted for Remain. Let's take the issue of Newham. Do people know Newham? It's a borough in London. It's got places like East Ham and West Ham. It's the most diverse borough in London. I think only about 15, 16% of it have people in it who describe themselves as ethnically white British. Newham only voted to Remain by 6,000 votes. And I haven't heard anyone talking about Newham, because I think it's a very, very interesting...
No, it is important. It's incredibly important.
It's very important. Here you have the most diverse borough, lots of people who are black, minority, ethnic, migrants, you'll have people who are second generation, third generation.
I went to Leicester and I spoke to Asians and West Indians, all of whom voted to leave.
Absolutely. So this is my problem. When people just keep telling you that people who voted leave, it's about immigration. In order to sort out where we are, we can't just have that narrative. There are lots of other narratives there. And I think what people were saying very clearly as well is they are dissatisfied with the type of politics that they've been having in this country. They're dissatisfied with everything being concentrated in London and in Westminster. And this was a time for people to voice their opinion. So I think part of what we have to do is not just look at the economy,
We have to start getting together, like Scotland did, and start thinking about what type of country do we want. And in order to get that, you have to have a range of voices engaged in that debate.
That must be right. Now, I want to take a question from Norton Hill School, which I'm going to slightly change because it's sort of jumping the gun a little bit. It says, could 16 and 17-year-olds be involved in any second referendum? So let's break that into two parts. Do you think there should be a second referendum? And if there were a second referendum, do you think we should widen the franchise and include 16 and 17-year-olds? Owen?
There can only be... If lots of people get, you know, what's called buyer's remorse, that is people who voted Leave and then see what's going to happen to the country and go, oops... And there's such a backlash, then you can see why a referendum would happen again. In the same way, if it had been a Remain by 52 to 48, I can guarantee the people who voted, the Brexiteers, they would have argued very clearly for a second referendum in the next few years. There's no point pretending otherwise. My working assumption is we voted to leave the European Union and we are going to vote, we're going to leave. I have to respect what the British people have said. And my main concern is struggling to make the best of it, to try and deal with the challenges it poses.
And what about 16, 17-year-olds? Yes, would you give them a vote?
Yes, I will have a quid pro quo approach. I believe that young people should have political education in schools, a kind of citizens' education, to inform young people about democracy. And the quid pro, the kind of like, in exchange for that, you get the right to vote. Because at the age of 16, 17, you can join the army and die for your country. You can work and pay taxes. You can settle down and have a family. So you have lots of kind of responsibility. You've got, you know, responsibilities, if you like, but you're lacking rights when it comes to what the government does on your behalf. And I think in terms of young people getting, to be honest, screwed over a lot in the last few years, I think if you'd had the vote, then we wouldn't have quite this. And just on that, you wouldn't have suffered quite as badly, to say the least. But this is my last urge. If more young people had voted, we'd still be in the European Union. Most young people didn't vote.
That's
the young
the
people
problem,
who did, the young people who did voted to stay very overwhelmingly, now, but not enough voted.
We haven't got a lot of time left, so if we could just keep this one reasonably short from Miriam and Dreda, and then I've got two other quick questions to pose to you. So, Miriam, quickly.
I don't think that there is any chance to have a second referendum. I think that this is irreversible. I think that if a second referendum would be put on the table, we would have people in the streets. This country is already sufficiently divided. I think that healing the country should be priority number one.
Okay.
I was, as I said earlier, absolutely in favor of 16, 17 years old voting in this referendum.
Well, yeah.
I take the comments about these are the rules. This is not a normal occasion. In normal elections, you can reverse whatever has been decided every 4 or 5 years. In this situation, we are going to live with the consequences of this for many years.
Dreda.
I mean, in terms of 16 to, you know, 17-year-olds, I think you should have the vote. I'm with Owen there. But I disagree with you. At the moment, these are the rules, and so we can't change them. I think a big issue is the turnout for that age group, the young people who turned out. It was low. So one of the things you have to do, please, please, use your vote. You must get out there and use your vote. I can't remember, what's the first half of the bit? What was it?
Whether you think there should be a second referendum.
Oh, second referendum. I tell you what I think will happen. I don't think there should be. It's a democracy. We've had a vote. But I think what's in lots of people's mind is the deviousness of politicians. And I think what lots of people are thinking is, if we do have a general election, whoever comes to power, somehow they will use whatever technicalities they can to somehow make sure we stay in the EU. That's what I've been hearing people say.
Right, so let's move on very quickly. So from Truro College, and this is, a quick question for the lawyer here, Miriam. When we leave the EU, how hard would it be to get employment in the rest of the European Union? You're the lawyer, you should know.
Well, it could be hard, but that depends on what kind of model we are going for. Basically, if we are in the model of the EEA, of the so-called Norway model, very little would change in terms of the relationship with the EU, and therefore it would be easy to get jobs in other European countries. If we go for the Swiss model, it would be more difficult. If we go for the Canada model, it would be even more difficult. And if we go, as Mr. Gove mentioned during the campaign for the Albanian model, it could be really, really difficult. So I can't really give an answer to that question because it depends on the model that we will have. And that is why we need some clarity about what is the plan. I think that whenever we will come to an election that I personally think that this should be put to the people to vote what kind of model they want, these are the kind of things that we need to hear. And I'm flabbergasted, really, that neither the government nor the Leave campaign, those who were leading the Leave campaign, seem to have any clue about what they want instead of being part of the European Union. It's just shocking.
Now, we've got very little time left. This is a question from an unnamed student. What are the ramifications on the legitimacy of the Human Rights Act? Does anybody want to pick that up?
It is separate. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, the government have already said they're going to get rid of the Human Rights Act. That was in their manifesto at the last general election. And you know what? The Human Rights Act is, it enshrines rights and freedoms our people actually fought for at great cost and great sacrifice. It was based on the European Convention of Human Rights that British lawyers and people very close to Winston Churchill helped draw up themselves. And actually, when it was introduced, it was actually the government giving away power. And now the idea that politicians are going to design on our behalf, I mean, look, the rights and freedoms that exist are rights and freedoms that protect us against authority. They protect us from the powerful. We're now going to have the powerful designing what rights and freedoms we're supposed to have, a so-called British Charter. I think it probably makes it, it will probably accelerate the process of getting rid of the Human Rights Act. And again, that's an attack on rights and freedoms, which you should enjoy.
Right, but now we've got a very easy last question because we're coming to the end of time. This is from Homewood School. And I suspect we could talk for an hour about this, but you've got a minute each. Do you feel Brexit will fundamentally change British politics after the dust has settled? Miriam.
I do, and I think that what I'm hoping that everybody who is against disengaging fully from the European Union, or at least to a large degree, does is to raise above party politics and to come together to ensure that we have the closest possible relationship with our neighbours. I think that it's not the time to look for differences. It's time to look for everything that unites us. And I hope that the current political mess that we are seeing goes in that direction. I keep hearing politicians, you know, it's easy always to blame the politicians. Those politicians are voted for by people. That is what you need to think. What is your power?
No, we've got literally no.
Look, it's already, look, we're in political turmoil now, so clearly it's going to have long-term ramifications in terms of politics. It could go in an ugly way, but to end on a more hopeful note, because it's been pretty pessimistic and depressing, a lot of that, I realise. It's up to you in this room. There's no question, the Leave campaign obviously ran on a very anti-immigration platform, but lots of people I grew up with were angry and frustrated, and they felt they're not being listened to, they're not being heard, and that's why they voted. There's huge sense of disconnection and anger, and politics now has to address that. It has to listen to that anger, but it's up to you, all of you. The future of this country really is in the hands of people here and people watching. And if you want a different sort of society, a more just and equal and fair society, then it is up to you to build it. And if you don't, then it won't happen.
Yes, I agree with all of that. One of the big things I would like to see, I'm a Labour Party supporter, I would like to see my Labour Party move away from people considering it to be a North London clique to it being one where it chooses MPs who come from the areas they live in, who are activists in the area they live in, and they look and sound like the people that they actually represent.
Now, I'm going to wrap this up with a slightly optimistic message. There has been a big shock to our way of life, but we are a robust country and we are a rich country. You know, there are going to be some challenging times, but we're definitely going to get through this. What I would say to all of you is, frankly, there hasn't been a period for years where jobs were easy to get, but they are going to get a little bit tougher for a while. And what I think that says is make the most of the opportunities you're being given here to acquire the skills, to acquire the qualifications that you need. Because in the kind of competitive world in which we live, and where actually access to the overseas labour market will be reduced a bit, you will be much better off the better qualified, the better skills you have. So I'm afraid you're just going to have to make the most of this very fine school. Thank you very much for tuning in. This was a Speakers for Schools TES event. Thank you very much.